Court, my name is Chris Grady. I represent plaintiff's appellants Tarleton LLC. In this case, about a district court's error in excluding an expert's sworn testimony, both in the form of a declaration and deposition testimony, when comparing inappropriately to an unsworn expert report and applying the sham affidavit rule improperly. Plaintiff appellant Tarleton LLC submits that the expert report, followed by the expert declaration, followed by the expert testimony regarding the various opinions about the direct and immediate cause of the trust collapse in this case, were all made within the scope of Rule 26. That's the appropriate rule governing this case. The sham affidavit rule does not apply. The court applied that.
I understand the sham affidavit rule has a very special application, and we don't have any case law that tells us that it applies here. I get that. Do we need actually to rely on the sham affidavit rule in order to get where the district judge got? I mean, what the district judge says, listen, your report says that there were contributory causes. One of them was the weight. But there are other ones, including the heat and the deterioration because of the heat and the, you know, this is it's a weak trust in the first place and it's been there for a long time. We get the sort of the checking and so on. That seems like a perfectly sensible report. Well, then we get a late filed affidavit from the same expert who says that the weight was the sole cause. Is the district judge entitled to say, not I'm going to call this a sham affidavit, but entitled to say, under the circumstances we face here, that second affidavit saying that the weight was the sole cause is simply unbelievable. So this, it doesn't even give us something that then gives us a disputed question of fact. It is to say, can you get there without the sham affidavit?
May I reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal?
Yeah, we'll try to give you some time for rebuttal.
Sure.
My apologies, sir. No, Your Honor. As Leslie versus Grupo states that it's not the court's job to weigh the credibility of the various.
Well, but it is and it isn't. I mean, if the offense says, based on my own knowledge and experience and my trip to the moon, I can tell you that it's made of green cheese, we don't have to believe it.
And I think the context here is important. The context in the changes in the various documents and then also in the context of the timing of the litigation are two very important things to look at here. One, we have all disclosures were made in a timely fashion. They were not made late or in disregard of the court scheduling orders. And second, the context for which those opinions were made, we had a building that's approximately 100 years old at the time of the collapse with trusses that were in place in the original construction, a truss collapse in 2006 followed by negligent engineer repair, followed by the 2011 collapse that was at issue in this particular coverage action. You have an engineer who in 2007 could not make the appropriate evaluation of the trust issues in that building. You had the State Farm's own expert in this case express uncertainty about what the causes were. And in the context of all of that information, we had an expert who discussed various factors and in the causation analysis for the collapse of the trust. And then what became clear during the course of the lawsuit was that the district court issued an opinion about where it was clear we needed to express the timing of the different causes of the various factors and the causes of the collapse. And what we had was the expert having the opportunity to review his uncertain opinion, which he clearly expressed.
No, but that puts a different gloss on it. Let me just ask in a different way, because I think another way of asking Judge Fletcher's question really is that Tarleton was the one that brought up Daubert, correct? So why couldn't the district court, why isn't all of this really under Daubert when you have somebody who says, I completely changed my opinion, I don't have any new evidence, and I've turned it upside down and I'm doing that because I don't have any evidence. Why couldn't the district court say, in light of this, this is a foundation for why I'm excluding the report?
Well, because what he excluded, the lack of foundation was the opinion on heat as a cause of the collapse. That's what lacked foundation, that opinion itself. And that opinion could be absolutely excluded for lacking evidentiary foundation or scientific evidence. but the withdrawal or exclusion of that opinion about heat and causation then is what the district court did not exclude.
Right, and it seems that when he basically says, look, he doesn't say, he says I changed my opinion, and he changes his opinion without anything other than we now have a new legal construct in it, so I'm going to try to shove my opinion into the new legal construct. There's something unseemly and inappropriate about that, that an expert ought to be able to do that.
Yeah, but also in the context, though, at the time he made his initial opinion, he expressed in the same sentence that he says heat is a factor. There is, and he can't find evidence, and yet he's concluding. So there's a contradiction.
Because it's likely a trigger of the bottom cord rupture.
Yet the evidence that he's forming that opinion upon, he can't see that there is evidence. So he's actually making, he's making a theory that he's expressing concern about at the time he makes it from the very beginning.
Well, but he's the expert, and he even cites something for that opinion. And then later off, he said, later on, he said, well, actually, it's my own theory. I don't have any evidence or any studies to support it. But that's belied by his report itself.
And those issues, we believe, are issues for the jury to determine his credibility, because clearly we met the guidelines of Rule 26 when, you know, the idea is to provide as much disclosure as possible, put that opinion in there, and to set sort of the scope of the landscape of his opinions, and then he can, you know, work on that.
Yeah.
But under your theory, you would actually exclude the first affidavit, right?
There was an expert report, then there was a...
I should say the report. The first report is the likely heat issue.
That particular part of the expert report, yes, sir.
I mean, there is something somewhat pernicious about that, where you would basically say, look, the guy completely changed his opinion, and we now want the court, and he did that following a legal opinion of how these things need to be worded, and now we want the court to completely X out. So how would the jury even be able to decide his credibility on this fundamental issue if you were correct about using Daubert to take out that section of his report?
I believe that he'd be subject to cross-examination about what his opinion was on heat, and then that would be a credibility determination in front of the jury, regardless of whether or not that sentence was excluded in the report. And he did raise the issue in his report. It's not as if this was a case of is causation, or, you know, was right, light red or green, and you change it from red to green. This is a case where you have multiple complicated factors that various experts have had difficulty explaining, and then there is a red flag about one of those factors, and it was disclosed.
Well, let me look at the language of the policy. The language of the policy is the collapse must have been, quote, directly and immediately caused only by the weight. So this is not your normal sort of proximate cause. It is directly and immediately caused only by the weight. And if we look at the expert report, your client loses, because the expert report says, well, a contributing cause was the heat of the very time, so we've got a direct and immediate cause that contributes. And then he backs away from it with no new evidence, no new inspection, and it's obvious that we have an intervening bit of legal advice that says, you know, if that's the report, we're in trouble. It seems to me that the district court gets to disregard the affidavit that, in effect, amends the considered expert report they'd previously prepared. And I'm not sure I need to get to sham affidavit. I just say I think the district judge gets to say, you know what, I just don't believe it. And under the circumstances here, it's simply not credible. And so not credible that it doesn't come in on sort of a, you know, I'm just glad views differ. I mean, it's just not credible. How do you respond? How can it be sufficiently credible that the district judge has to let this go to the jury?
I believe, Your Honor, because there was an uncertain opinion expressed in the report in and of itself. Had the expert said, the cause of this collapse is, and the last cause of time is heat, and there's nothing else, and then he withdraws it, that's a problem. But but we have a numerous amount of factors and a direct express of uncertainty by that expert about that particular factor among many in a complicated issue that he withdraws. And so
really, then we run into trouble with that word in the policy. This is only weight.
And that, Your Honor, the parties did not dispute the district court's interpretation of the phrase directly and immediately caused only by. The court issued a prior opinion in another State Farm case, so that our opinion is that the district court made a plausible interpretation of that policy, so we're now to the last clause of time. And among those various causes that flow through time, you have the last clause is the weight of contents and equipment. And I do agree with the court that if the court does not reverse the district court on its exclusion of Mr. Uni's opinion on heat being a cause, that then there is no tribal issue fact.
Thank you.
I'm Brian Hickman. I'm here on behalf of Defendant State Farm Fire and Casualty Company. Our chief concern here is the ability to use the tool of summary judgment to resolve cases involving expert testimony. The way I see this, if you adopt plaintiff's position, any time that I or any other defense counsel is faced with an opportunity to move for summary judgment based on the expert's report, we're going to have to hold that argument. We're going to have to wait until trial to do that. Because if we move for summary judgment, if we accept this rule, they can just change their opinion. And I'm concerned about how that impacts defendants as well as the courts, because we'll be waiting for trial.
Would it be a different situation, and this does happen with experts, is that he provides a preliminary expert report under Rule 26, and then there's more discovery, or he goes out and consults other sources and says, I want to modify my opinion because of these three factors. Would that be a different case?
Yes. If there's new evidence after the original opinion, then there's at least an argument that a supplementation can be made under Rule 26.
But you're not suggesting, and could he change his opinion?
I think if that was done after the motion for summary judgment is filed without any prior notice, then I think you're into the sham affidavit rule. Because if instead what we had here was, we had, I believe, 3 months between the original expert report and then the declaration, if prior to State Farm filing for summary judgment, it even just sent a letter saying, hey, look, I put this in my opinion, reevaluating it, we're not sure if we can support this, maybe you would have a better argument.
Why does it matter? You filed for summary judgment, but the judge hasn't ruled on summary judgment. So it's not a situation where summary judgment was, for example, denied to State Farm, and now we're ready to go to trial, and he says, oh, by the way, I have this whole other opinion. It's still part of this fluid process where the judge is looking at Rule 56 and has not yet decided it. So I'm not sure why the mere filing of the summary judgment motion is some kind of talismanic trigger.
I think that's a central part of the sham affidavit rule. I've read multiple cases on that. That seems to be a central fact. You can't submit an affidavit for the sole purpose of creating an issue of fact or summary judgment. So when you have a supplementation that could have occurred prior to the summary judgment but just happens to occur afterwards as part of the response, the court's naturally suspicious of it. And in this case, I think why the court applied the sham affidavit rule is not only do we have this complete 180 change in opinion, but then when we take his deposition, he's back to saying that he likely contributed to the collapse. And that is in the record. He testified after the declaration that it's known that heat reduces the strength of wood.
Where are you with that deposition?
This is excerpt of record, page 98 and 99.
If that's the case, then why wouldn't summary judgment simply be appropriate based on that opinion?
I think it is. I think
you wouldn't need to get to the sham affidavit, right?
You know, if you just say there's no genuine issue of material fact because the expert has contradicted himself so much and his final statement was he likely contributed to the collapse, I think so. However, I also think it's a proper application of the sham affidavit rule.
But we would be extending that then to Rule 26 reports, which have not been swept in at this point, correct?
Perhaps. You could also do it by comparing the declaration to the subsequent deposition testimony. Then you could use the subsequent sworn deposition testimony as the comparative document to strike the affidavit.
This is not, I'm now off the sort of the procedural question about sham affidavits and whether we should apply them in the context of expert testimony and so on, or reports. I'm trying to figure out actually the meaning of the policy. So go with me on my assumption of fact. I'm not asking you to concede, but let's assume that the trust is loaded heavily.
Okay.
Let's assume further that it is quite predictable that the trust is weaker in hot weather and that the trust is loaded up in the middle of the winter. But anybody with a knowledge of materials in this trust will tell you that as soon as it gets hot in the summer, this is going to collapse. Now, what's the immediate cause? I overload it with this sure knowledge that as soon as summer comes, it's gone. It collapses. What's your policy say?
So if you go under the interpretation from the Jugens decision, which is the closest cause in time, then it's heat, because the contents were added many months, more likely a year or so before. And then heat, you put it perfectly in the original report, it's the trigger. It's the closest cause in time. Both experts agreed that what you have is you have an upward sloping demand curve and a downward sloping capacity curve. Your collapse occurs at that time. There's a number of factors that go into both of them, but the closest cause in time then would be the heat of the day that actually triggered the collapse. Interestingly, though, plaintiff's expert also testified in a subsequent deposition, and this is at ER 104, that it's fair to say that deterioration occurred after the contents were added. So we've got not only heat after the contents were added, but we also have continued deterioration of the strength of the wood, and that comes from the original use of green wood, which causes the cracking as it dries, and that wood was continually getting weaker.
Well, that the testimony that we have on that is that the drying and the weakening takes place fairly early on and then it stabilizes.
Well, he did say in his depo that he's fair to say it occurred after the contents were added. So there's contradictory parts within the deposition itself. I'd like to point out, too, that in the original report, counsel is arguing that this opinion was basically flagged as uncertain. That's not the way I read it. What the original report says is, I have not conducted tests on this specific wood, so I don't have a specific way of saying that heat definitely affected this wood. However, in my experience, that's the likely trigger. And that's the same thing he said in his deposition, that he was relying on his experience, which we know that that's what an expert can do. So it was his opinion before the declaration that heat contributed to it, and it was his opinion after the declaration that heat contributed to it. And I think that's why the sham affidavit rule is so appealing in this case. You're looking at a declaration that directly contradicts both an expert report and subsequent deposition testimony. It is a sham.
Well, I think here, at least between the lines of some of the questions to the bench, why we're a little leery of adopting wholesale the sham affidavit rule with respect to expert reports.
Understood. In which case, the alternative arguments are like you mentioned, that there's simply no genuine issue of material fact. And alternatively, the district court's opinion could be supported under Rule 37, the Yeti by Molly case. The initial expert report violated Rule 26A because it did not include all opinions. Wasn't a proper supplementation under Rule 26E because it wasn't based on new evidence. I believe that's the Avila case. So we've got a violation of Rule 26A. We've got a self-executing sanction under Rule 37. That provides a sufficient basis to support the district court's opinion.
Could the district court, since he says, I withdraw my opinion, report number one, but then he says, his new opinion is not based, it's based on the lack of any evidence or data. Could the district court also say, well, under Daubert, that's a vacuum and I can't let this in? The second
opinion. Yeah, the second opinion, correct. Well, he's saying it's, I think there's a number of ways you can get there. You have odd circumstances with the expert contradicting himself. I think it is vulnerable under Daubert. I think it's vulnerable under genuine issue of material fact. Obviously, we support the district court's application of the sham affidavit rule, and it's also should be stricken under Rule 37. That's at least four different ways that the law does not countenance this kind of thing. It would erode the ability of parties to file for summary judgment, which then just increases the stress on the courts, obviously. So I did want to point out, you know, closely in his deposition testimony, it's on ER 99, he says, I think it, referring to temperature, probably contributed to the situation. So he's saying this after filing that declaration. If you proceed under Rule 37, there's an argument that the court would have needed to make a finding of willfulness, faults, or bad faith in order to go ahead and strike the declaration. As we put in our briefs, we don't think that's actually the case, but I just wanted to point out the court's finding under the sham affidavit rule that the affidavit was sham, that's equivalent to a finding of willfulness, faults, or bad faith. The dictionary defines sham as something that is not what it appears to be and is meant to trick or deceive. So that the district court made the necessary findings to support this, an affirmance under Rule 37 as well. Are there any questions, any further questions for me?
No, okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I would like to point out the deposition testimony for Mr. Uri.
Can you move forward in front of the mic?
Thank My apologies. Thank
That's
you.
Okay.
I would like to point out that there is deposition testimony in the reply brief. It is ER references, ER 115 for Mr. Uri's deposition testimony, where he explains that he cannot maintain that heat is a cause of the collapse. And I think it's important to, again, take a step back and look at the context for which these opinions were issued and the role of Rule 26, which is primarily to identify scope so that everything is out in front of the parties. Had the State Farm folks taken the deposition of Mr. Uni, and Mr. Uni's deposition then was contradictory with a subsequent declaration, then you might have a sham affidavit rule in place. State Farm did not take his deposition until after the summary judgment, so we don't have that rule that would apply under these circumstances. However, that was State Farm's choice to do that in light of the, again, this red flag that was raised by Mr. Uni in his original report, which was not sworn.
Thank you. Thank you both for your argument. Very interesting question. Tarleton versus State Farm is submitted. We'll now hear argument in Schwerin versus Plunkett.